connected. I, as a person who lives in Ramallah, which is only 15 kilometers away from Jerusalem, I cannot go to Jerusalem. And the Arabs, the Palestinians in Jerusalem, are not allowed to marry from other Palestinians, from another city. And if you marry, which happens all the time, you have to live, the husband has to live in Ramallah and the woman has to live in Jerusalem. And if the woman joins her husband in Ramallah, she loses her residency because the Israelis are trying very hard. Now, this photo is really about this mixed marriages. We are all Palestinians, but by Israeli law, a Palestinian Israel, if you marry someone from the West Bank, you lose your residency. If Jerusalem, they lose your residency. So here, they have many times marriages across cities. Like New Delhi is not allowed to marry from Bombay, you know what I mean? So there are marriages all the time, and they have to cross the checkpoint. And they, you know, as the photo shows, they are in their wedding and, you know, with flowers. I once went through a checkpoint with holding the flowers. And I jokingly asked the soldier, the Israeli soldiers, to hold the flowers. Meanwhile, I was looking for something. So when you live in a place like Israel, really, it is out of this world. That's why I called it, nothing makes sense, why should I? Nothing makes sense in this place. For example, just a detail. The Israelis have built the wall lately. They wanted to separate the Israelis from the Arabs. Meanwhile, they have taken 15% of our land. They did not build the wall on the border. They just went like this and grabbed 15% of our land. Why are you building the land? Because we want to separate the Palestinians from the Israelis for security reasons. But I want you to know that on the Israeli side, you have almost 1.5 million Arabs on their side, which are Arab citizens in Israel. You have 250,000 of Arabs in East Jerusalem. So you almost have almost 2 million Arabs on the Israeli side. So how are you separating Arabs from Israelis? And on our side, we have 500,000 settlers every day. They build settlements and take more land from our. So how are you to understand this wall, which is separating Israelis from Palestinians? Meanwhile, they're coming on our side and taking more and more land. So really, I always say that in Palestine, you have to take the logic out. Really, if you have logic, you go crazy because nothing makes sense. Nothing makes sense. Here you are. You are absent where you are physically present. You cannot marry from across. So everything they do is so. They talk about they want to be part of the Middle East and they build this wall. And I always say, what would the world have done if we have built such a wall around the Israeli or the Jewish community? We will be bombarded from the skies. And here they are, they built it. And I always say, this war really is about a mentality. It is about how scared they are. And how, I always tell the Israelis in their eyes, you know that you have robbed us, you have stolen our homes, our land. And that's why you are scared. You are the strongest nation on earth when it comes to an army. And we are the weakest when it comes to military. But if you come to Palestine tomorrow and to Israel, you will find that the powerful nation are really the Palestinians because we have a mentality that this land is ours. We don't have to prove anything. We don't have to. We know it's ours. And they have to invent all sorts of realities. And as a result, always the occupier feel very insecure. And I think they are extremely insecure. And fear is the world that they live on. I don't know what I'm saying, but that's it.
Mr. Bukhi, I am Aditya and I'm a lawyer. Oh, okay. Scary. So, no, so I first of all want to thank you for the presentation you made. You have been very insightful. And I do respect your emotions and the hardships that you and your people have gone through. But I genuinely feel that you, in your book, and from as Mr. Dharkar had read, you have given a sort of a one-sided opinion. Now, if you go back to history, I understand you have gone sufferings and it seems that you are prejudiced in favor of your people. You say the Israelis kicked out the Palestinians. Okay, I don't doubt the fact that Palestinians may have been kicked out. But the fact remains that even after the separation happened, within the original boundaries of Israel, there are almost 600,000-700,000 Arabs. And the rights which they enjoy in Israel, there is prejudice, there is discrimination. But the rights which Arabs enjoy in Israel, they would never be enjoyed by a Jew who would stay in Saudi Arabia. So I believe that you are trying to, I personally feel that you are trying to give a one-sided portrayal and assassinating the Israeli legal system. There may be flaws. Today even in India also you have discrimination. But the scale on which you have portrayed...
Well, what's
I
your
feel
question? Like a, can you come yes. to the question?
No, I'm making...
You are a lawyer.
Yes. Now second, coming to the Adoni part. Yes. Let me say if the same matter was in India, he came to his house after 90 years. You haven't told us why the judge reasoned. Because if the same case was in India, he would also lose his house. Because in India, after 12 years, you lose your house.
After what?
After, if you don't attend to your property for 12 years, unauthorized occupation, you lose your house. It's a common thing everywhere around the world.
If you leave your house for 12 years, you lose your house?
Yes, if a person is an unauthorized occupation of a house for 12 years. No, it's not that. No, what I'm saying is that you haven't portrayed why. You haven't portrayed the... Because this happens everywhere around the world, not just in Israel.
So, okay, so...
Yeah.
Listen, I am a Palestinian. I tell the Palestinian side. I never said I am neutral to this question. Don't I have the right to tell my story? This is, you are talking to a person who have lost their house in Jaffa. And I am the person who was ready to accept the two-state solution. You know what that means? You know what that means? Well, that's the...
I think you're being obnoxious. All right? I, as a director of this institution, can tell you that you're being obnoxious. So, sorry. Hello? I don't want to hear it anymore. All right? It's been a very pleasant evening, and I'm sorry, I do not want to hear your voice anymore.
He had the question before we finished, by the way.
It's been a very pleasant evening, and it's been a very poignant evening. And if you have a problem, you can leave.
We always have one person sense. I am used to that.
No. I'm sorry, I'm not used to it. This place is a private institution.
Is it $50? Normally in the States, they pay them $50. I hope they paid you more this time. Really, I tell you something.
No. Right, this is a private institution, and I'm sorry, but I'm not going. This is not the United Nations, all right? We're talking to somebody who's an artist here. She's here because of the book she's written and because of the thing. And if you have a problem with that, please leave. Anything else? Anybody else? Please, can we have a better evening? And I'm sorry that you messed it up big time.
It's not messed up at all. She was wonderful.
No, he...
Yeah. Forget him, exactly. Here I am, very charming. I am going to tell you another story. Listen. Yeah. I just want to tell you, really, we are... Nobody can oppress us. I want you to know that, you know, with a big smile. We have justice on our side, and you all know it. And we can smile, we can laugh in spite of everything that happened to us. And here I want to tell you the story about my dog. To come back to life and to a nice story. I love animals, really I love animals. And I don't know, in my book, Sharon and my mother-in-law, I told this story. My publisher in America said that the one thing that made publicity for Palestine more than anything else was your dog. And I happened to have a little dog. At first, I had a big dog, and the big dog was a female, and she had no breed. It was a baladi dog. Baladi in Arabic means my country, but it also means no breed. So there was one... Do we have 3 minutes, right, to change the mood?
Oh, I need just 1 minute to change.
Okay. So I had this vet in Palestine, in Ramallah, who was sexist and who was anti. He came to give a vaccine to my dog. And he said, Saad, you want to spend $20 on this bitch? And this, it's a female dog and it's a baladi. Are you? I was so annoyed by him being so anti-woman. So eventually I had a dog. Without making a long story, I ended up in an Israeli vet, a doctor, Tamar. Her name is Tamar. And she was so cute with Noura, and she played with my little dog. And then she goes back and she says, Saad, I'm afraid I can't give the vaccine to your dog. And I said, why, Dr. Tamar, you can't give the vaccine? Where does Noura live? Noura is the name of the dog. I said, Noura lives with me in Ramallah. In Ramallah, I am afraid these vaccines are only for Jewish dogs of West Jerusalem. And I said, come on, Dr. Tamar, you must be joking. You discriminate against me as a Palestinian, I fully understand. But to discriminate against my dog because she lives in Ramallah, this is not possible. So Dr. Tamar was very sympathetic, actually. She goes out, she says, if you pay $30, I can give her the vaccine. She goes out and comes back, and Dr. Tamar had a document in her hand, and the document said, passport. And I look at the health certificate, and I say, passport? Noura Habibti, do you realize you are getting an Israeli passport? 4 million Palestinians will kill to have that passport. And you know what the vet tells me? Suan, she calls. Suan, when you go to Ben Gurion Tel Aviv airport, please make sure to take the passport. I say, Noura Habibti, do you understand? I, as a Palestinian, I am not allowed to use the airport. And I am not allowed to go to Jerusalem. And my dog saying, yeah, mama, I managed to get an Israeli passport. So I said, okay, let's get going. So I carry Noura with my right hand, and I carry the document in my right hand, and Noura on my left hand, and I come out of the doctor, and I said, you know what, Noura? Let's go to Jerusalem. And mama, she looks at me, the dog, and she says, mama, but you don't have the documents to allow you to go to Jerusalem. I said, don't worry, mama is clever, come with me. So I get in the car, and I start driving the car, and I get to Qalandia checkpoint where you enter Jerusalem. And 5 Israeli soldiers come to me. Where are you going? I said, I'm going to Jerusalem. And he said, and how are you going to Jerusalem? Do you have a permit? I said, I don't have a permit to go to Jerusalem. I don't have a permit. I need a permit, but you never give me one. Huh, does your car has a permit? Oh, my car, no, I don't have a permit for my car. And the soldier gets fed up, you know. He says, and how do you expect to go to Jerusalem? I said, yeah, you have not met Noura, my dog. And he says, he says, Maze. I said, you heard me, you haven't met my dog. Come, Habibti, come. So I sit here. And Noura, come. She jumps here and she gets her head out of the window and she's looking at the Israeli soldiers like this. And I say, this is Noura, my dog. And he says, yes. And I said, and this is her passport. It's a passport from Jerusalem. And Noura doesn't know how to drive. And I happen, and I happen to be her driver. And he says, yes. I said, she doesn't know how to drive. I happen to be a driver. He says, you know what? Go.
this is...
Thank you very much. Really, thank you. Don't worry about them. They get paid, I swear.
That was wonderful. I mean, I'm sure... She can keep us regaling all night.
I tell you, I'm going to be on stage next time I come to London.
But this is when you can talk about tragedy being so poignant and yet set in the most light, funny way possible. There could be nothing more poignant than putting it in these ways. So thank you all for coming, and a big hand to... Come back. You're going to get her back, right?
Yes.
You're going to get her back.
Yeah, wonderful. It must be a lovely book.
It's a book, yeah.